How long ago was when I remodeled Jim Fresh Run over there?
Oh, geez, let's see. It was before you were married. Your son is 23. It had to be about 26 years, 25, 26.
We're dragging up too many, we're opening too many closet doors.
Okay.
We're going to go
eat lunch. All right. Have fun. They changed the sign from Jim's Drive-In to Jim's Family Restaurant.
It felt like it was safer that way.
Back in my younger, wilder days, I had done a little redecorating for this restaurant we're going to. I parked about a 1960-something Duster through the wall. Back in, it was called Jim the Drive-In. I went through the drive-in section, replaced your order, straight into the wall, through the wall, and parked on top of a local doctor's table, which the table was flattened to the floor then, so was him and his wife's dinner. The police tried to hang me for it, which they should have, because it literally done thousands of dollars of damage just a lot of years ago. Police asked me what happened, and I said, well, the sign says Jim's Drive-In, so I did.
We never really had a chance at all. I was carrying more luggage than a U-Haul truck could haul. And I had it all worked out. We'd only be the best of friends. Now I gotta get over you. I gotta get over you again. Maybe I never really got over you at all. And I've been looking in the mirror.
Not a lot to say about him except that thank goodness he's one of kind, and he's been an experience to have his son, that's for sure. He was always different, always good at what he's good at, and totally disinterested in that which he's not. I think it's called single-mindedness.
Yeah, that's a chainsaw quick cut. And once you do a piece, you gotta burn it. So, I noticed a while ago, the end of this fish wasn't quite good enough.
What is David's name?
So, I'll give you a little bit of an idea on the burning technique. Now this is borderline insanity. We were talking about how many artists was in this area. And I found that art generally comes from a very rural, poor area where there's a lot of money and isolated area. And I think sometimes it might be due to that poorness, that isolation, the boredom you feel when you're in your adolescence and young. You've got to do something besides watch the chickens peck, so you tend to start wanting to draw or doodle or write a song or something to occupy yourself, and it becomes art. Because, you know, some of the greatest artists in the world has came from relatively poor, isolated regions. And oftentimes, poor, isolated regions will give you what you need to live very easy. So you're comfortable, your belly's full, but you're bored. And you begin to dream. And essentially that's what art is. Any kind of art is a dream. It's bringing the unmanifested to manifestation. That's where it begins.
Do you think if you had grown up in a more urban area, you still would have ended up being an artist?
Now that's a really good question. I think the talent and the inclination would have been there, but I don't think I'd ever took the time to tap into it as well. Because I'd have probably been a lot more trouble if I'd have had a lot more trouble to get into it. So I don't think I'd ever really utilized it. You know, I think the talent would have been there. But I think that's something that's kind of born in you.
So when he graduated high school, he worked here in the hardware for a short period while he was married. That was a very short period. And then he started doing folk art and woodworking and that kind of thing. So one weekend he and his lady friend went up in Tennessee. And he saw this man out in a convenience store parking lot chainsawing an Indian. So he stopped. This he had to see. And the man's name is L.D. Cooper. He's a master chainsaw carver. He took time to talk to Jim and to tell him, yeah, you can do this, son. You can do this. If you can whittle, you can do this. So Jim came home. He went to the pawn shop straight away, bought a chainsaw this long, smoked like a freight train, cleaned out mosquitoes for a quarter mile, and started chainsaw carving. And after a few loads of firewood, he started producing recognizable shapes. And I have his first cigar store Indian, by the way, standing by the side of my fireplace. Unfortunately, he kind of ran out of wood before he ran out of Indian, and his legs are about this long, but he's still an Indian, you know.
This is some of the more chaotic end of the shop in a lot of ways. This is a fish chair that I was working on. Talk about a dance along lunatic fringe, but that's what this mounted to. But it actually sits right comfortable. Long thing. Why is Santa Claus sitting among fish? Well, there's actually a very logical explanation about that. Cold up there in the North Pole. I guess he wanted to get warm and go down around Florida and take a vacation. More wood spirits. You've got more canes. A mouse cane. Don't ask me what happened to me, it just happened. But he ain't bothering nobody, man. He's just sitting up there and taking it easy. And then from a mouse, I got a hobgoblin cane.
What is a hobgoblin exactly?
I have no idea. My grandmama used to say they're gonna get me. So maybe she traumatized me into carving one. I'm not sure what happened there. What's frightening is it bears a slight resemblance to the carver, especially in the nose. But we don't want to talk about that. This piece here, I've done it to represent the unity of nature. How the predatorial grizzly and the predatorial raptor both intertwine in the same energies. It's a constant circle of giving and taking in all of life. And these old boys here are kind of a zanier type thing. Those are tree spirits. They originated, the legend of the tree spirits originated in Bavaria, in the Bavarian regions and the Black Forest regions. And they're the keepers of order in the forest. The old saying is, if you knock on wood, it'll bring you good luck. And they're who you're not knocking to. You're acknowledging their existence, and they'll bring you good fortune. So there was one custom, when your daughter got married, you carved out a tree spirit that represented how you felt about your new son-in-law. And I bet they were ugly for the most part. But some things are the same no matter where you are. Traditionally, they all had long beards, long hair, and I think I've carved so many of them, I'm turning into one. About every time I carve one now, somebody comes by and says, is that a Seth portrait? And I'm thinking, well, not yet, but give it time. I met a gentleman one time named Emil, and I can't even begin to say his last name. He was from that region originally, and Emil couldn't speak English, but through an interpreter I found out that as a child, the monks that pertained to this belief in that region raised strawberries and did the carvings of him, and they called them Wurzelsephs. And as a child, he was doctored by them for the thrash or something, strep throat, some minor like that. With herbs. So they served a very important part in that region. And before the interpreter got to us, he got to me before the interpreter did. And when he walked up, man, he was excited and hugging me, patting me on the back. I couldn't understand nothing he was saying. The guy that brought him there couldn't either. And I'm asking, what's this all about, you know? I mean, I'm friendly, but I'm not that friendly. And I didn't understand what was going on because he was just so excited. And he come to find out he thought I was one of those monks because traditionally they don't shave or get a haircut. And then I had these carvings around. So he automatically assumed that I was one who had survived Hitler's onslaught and made it to America, my ancestry, and it was passed down. And I hated to tell him that no, I was just scroungy looking and like carved wood, you know, but I had to tell him that no, I wasn't. But he refused to call me anything but Wurzelseph the whole time we were there.